Hello everyone and welcome to this week's episode of the Aftermath series. Let us waste no time at all and dive right into this week's episode of Critical Role. But actually, before we begin, I have a very special guest with me today in the studio audience. So stay tuned till the end to see a nice blooper reel where I tried to give her the lines of how to run the Aftermath episode. It's quite hilarious, so be sure to check it out. But anyways, so first thing we're going to be talking about is the Cerberus Assembly and the Cobalt Soul and how they don't exactly meet eye to eye. Now we know that the Cobalt Soul is all about the balance of power, and the Cerberus Assembly is threatening to tip that balance into the Assembly's favor. And we also got information from Dairon that she believes that a few members of the Assembly may actually be in league and working with the Kryn Dynasty. Now, I do have some theories of my own on who those might be. The first one being Dolan Tversky, the Archmage of Dysology. Now, if that name sounds familiar, you would be correct. Dolan Tversky is somehow connected to Nott's backstory. Now, Dysology is essentially the study of academic blind spots. There are a few more definitions, but academic blind spots is the one we're going to focus on. And so why I think Dolan Tversky might be one of the betrayers is because he studies these academic blind spots. And Dunamancy, this magic that the Kryn Dynasty have a hold of, could potentially be considered a blind spot since it's a newfound school of magic. And I would assume someone who studies blind spots would be very interested in learning more. Maybe so interested that they'd be willing to divulge certain secrets of the Empire. The other potential betrayer is Vess Duragna, the Archmage of Antiquities. Now we know that Dunamancy, the magic, resides in some various artifacts and holy relics of the Kryn Dynasty. So because Duragna studies antiquities, it makes sense that she would want as many of these Dunamantic objects as possible. And in order to get more of them, she may have to trade secrets and information to the dynasty. But let me know what you guys think. Those are my sort of running theories. Do you think any of the other Archmages may be in league with the Kryn Dynasty? Let me know in the comments below. Also, as a quick side note, my green screen and lighting is acting up a little bit, so the background is going to be doing this weird thing that I'm sure you've noticed by now. Oh, yep, there it goes. Try to disregard it. I tried fixing it. I don't know what to do. Moving on. But besides Tversky's and Duragna's reasoning for betraying the Empire and the Cerberus Assembly, is there any other reason? I believe the answer is yes. So we do know that the Cerberus Assembly acts as the sort of council to the king. However, the Assembly wasn't always the Assembly. They're sort of bound together and to work with the king because of a great war between the mages that happened 150-ish years ago in Rexxentrum that almost resulted in the destruction of Rexxentrum. But then the king at the time gave them an ultimatum, either join together and act as my council or essentially be executed, as I assume was the other option. And so it's possible that the Assembly feels bound and trapped with the Empire, with no way out. However, with this newfound power, perhaps they may see a way out of this deal they've gotten themselves into. And what better way to tip the scale in their favor than by being on the council with the king? That's a pretty high and mighty position to have. And if these Archmages obtain this new Dunamantic power, I don't think it'll take much to completely overthrow the king and the entire Empire. But again, that's just a theory I'm sort of working with. Let me know what you guys think down below. Now, the next thing I want to talk about is the reunion between Beauregard and her mentor, Dairon. Now, this conversation was rather heavy in the sense that it's obvious that Beauregard very much looks up to Dairon as this sort of parental figure, perhaps. But it was just clear that Beau was really trying to impress Dairon. Dairon seems to be the only one that Beau really cares about to impress. And what's sad is that it looked as though Beau felt betrayed and hurt that Dairon wasn't giving Beau the credit she thought she deserved. And Beau feels betrayed, she felt abandoned, because Dairon had said to Beauregard that she was going to be going to Blade Garden for no more than a month. But then more than a month had passed and Beau received no word from Dairon until Jester reached out to her and Beau found out that she was injured, which turned out to be a lie, which only adds on to this feeling of hurtfulness and betrayal that Beau may have been feeling in that conversation they were having. We have to look at it in Beau's perspective. You know, she's probably had her fair share of loss and abandonment with her with her parents probably not believing in her, just sending her to the Cobalt Soul Monks because her parents didn't want to deal with her anymore. And then the very mentor that took her just in Bo's eyes, abandons her. And the same mentor isn't recognizing all of the hardships that Bo has been going through, all of the lessons she's learned, all of the growth she's endured. We see everything that Bo has gone through. We've seen the transformation she's undergone. But Dairon isn't seeing that. And if she is, she doesn't want Bo to see that, because Dairon wants Bo to reach her fullest potential, which is also why she's so hard on Bo. And all Bo wants is to be validated. She wants that validation that yes, she's doing a good job. Yes, she's on the right track. That's all she really wants from Dairon. And Dairon isn't exactly giving it to her. She's just giving her more advice. And through their sparring session, she's teaching her more techniques, which, by the way, was a brilliant narrative way to weave in some class changes. Well done, Matt. But anyways, it was very hard to see Bo just so desperate for that validity, desperate for Dairon to encourage her and say that she's doing the right thing. And luckily, they did not end on a sour note. It does appear that Dairon does deeply care about Bo and her safety, and she really does want to see her succeed in life. But just the nature of Dairon and her personality and the way Bo is, Dairon doesn't exactly show emotion very well. But honestly, neither does Bo. So it's this very interesting of these two like stoic, abrasive, sturdy characters sort of butting heads and trying to have some semblance of like a healthy relationship. It's just such a very interesting dynamic. And I know I'm rambling and I may not be making any sense, but please let me know what you all think of this sort of conversation, the dynamic between Dairon and Beauregard. Let me know in the comment section below, because I think this conversation and all of this pressure that Bo is putting on herself, because she holds herself in such a high regard, in such a high standard, that she feels she's not doing enough. Well, now she doesn't feel like she's doing enough, since Dairon made it seem like she's not doing enough. So now Bo has to figure out what she needs to do to impress her mentor, the one person that she looks up to. And I'm worried that all of this pressure may cause Bo to have some sort of a breakdown down the line. Now, I'm not 100% on that, since we know Bo to be this very sturdy mountain of a character. But with all of this pressure she is putting on herself, she may have some sort of a breakdown or some sort of a awakening or an enlightening about what she needs to do for herself. But moving on, the last thing that I want to talk about is the bad dreams and nightmares that were taking over the night of Asarius. We do now know through this episode that it was a succubus and an incubus that were causing these nightmares, and it's most likely possible that they are connected with these abyssal rifts that are forming. And it's also likely that they are not the last remaining remnants of these abyssal creatures that are in Asarius. But wouldn't it be interesting if the succubus and incubus were the cause of these rifts? Perhaps they just wanted a good time, they wanted to feast on the souls of mortals, so they entered our plane, but accidentally lost control of these rifts, and more of them started popping up, and now creatures are just entering and running rampant in Asarius. That could potentially be the case. However, I'm more under the assumption that there's going to be more to these abyssal rifts, and these succubus and incubus are just a result of these rifts appearing. But again, let me know what you all think of that down below. And the last thing that I want to talk about is just a small thing, but I thought it was quite hilarious. It was a nice sort of flashback to Grog, in the sense that Ford was talking with this bugbear that sort of led to this connection of the succubus and the bad dreams. It seemed as though Ford was like talking to Grog in a way. The intelligence level of the bugbear seemed to be on the same level as Grog, so just seeing the back and forth of Ford and this bugbear was just really hilarious, since, as we know, Travis was Grog in the previous campaign, so it was kind of like him talking to himself, so it was a bit of a taste of his own medicine. I really enjoyed that moment, as I'm sure many of you did as well. And with all of that being said, we are going to wrap up this episode, but a quick little side note. If you are passionate about Critical Role and love the universe that Matthew has built, I am looking for extremely talented writers to help with a project I am currently working on. I will leave a link to my Twitter down below. My DMs will be open if you want to reach out, or you can simply let me know in the comment section below. But if you know someone who is a talented writer that is passionate about Critical Role, let them know. I have a lot of exciting things on the horizon for you guys. I'm just looking for those talented writers to help my ideas come to fruition. And now, I hope you all have an absolutely wonderful rest of your weekend, and I will see you all next week. And now, enjoy a nice blooper reel of my friend Yanna, who joined me today, and watch her attempts at trying to do an episode of the Aftermath series. Something to note is that she does not watch Critical Role, so just keep that in mind as we run the reel. Enjoy.
Hello everyone, and welcome back to...
Nope.
Let us waste no time at all and dive into this episode of...
Critical Role.
First, we're going to be talking about how the Cerberus Assembly and the Cobalt...
Soul.
The Cobalt Assembly. The Assembly is all about having power. And... In this episode, we've got some juicy details about how the Assembly is potentially working with the Kreen Dynasty.
Oh, that was perfect! That was good!
We're thinking that the likely candidates for this betrayal are Archmage
Archmage Tversky.
We're thinking that the likely candidates for this betrayal are Archmage Tversky. We're thinking that the likely candidates for this betrayal are Archmage Tversky and Duragna. Were those correct words?
Close enough.
What was it?
Tversky.
Okay. And our reasoning for Duragna, So it would make sense, due to their field of studies, that these... What are they called? So it would make sense due to the field of study of these... Why am I learning these words? Archmage Dunamancy.
Yes!
So now that it sounds like I know what I'm talking about, I'm gonna hand it right back over to Nico.
Yeah. Hey guys, the expert's back.